On Reddit, someone recently asked, "Can someone please explain implicit to me like I'm five?" They've been trying to understand implicit for hours and read so many different articles, and their head is all over the place, and yet they really don't get the main idea behind implicit. Why do they need to use it? When? Why? Can someone explain to me as simple as possible? They would really appreciate it. And there were a bunch of answers, but I thought, why not an answer in a video format? I might assume a bit more than you're just five. Maybe you're a very precocious five-year-old who also understands basic Scala syntax, but I'll try to break it down as simply as possible. Luckily, there are really only two sorts of implicits in Scala, and we're going to look at them separately. First, there are something called implicit parameters, and then there's something called implicit conversions. And then there are a whole bunch of crazy patterns that are built upon these two fundamental powers of the Scala language. So we'll investigate those after. But first, implicit parameters. Usually, when you define a method, like, say, add, it has a normal parameter list, a non-implicit parameter list, and you would call these with numbers and get back a result. We can print the result out right now. Let's run this. Wow, 3. Notice how we're explicitly passing the parameters into this method, just as you do in basically every programming language in the world. But Scala allows us to do something else. Scala allows us to have implicit parameters. Let's make a method called addImplicit. This will take the first argument as an explicit parameter, but the second one, the y, will be an implicit parameter. It can have the same exact body, and now we can call this just by passing in a single parameter. Unfortunately, you can see here with the red squiggles that this is not going to work, because Scala could not find an implicit value for parameter y. When you add this implicit keyword at the beginning of a parameter list, you're telling Scala that it should search high and low for a value of that type. But in order to find a value of that type, you need a corresponding implicit definition. So right above this, perhaps, I'll say implicit val and just give the number 100 here. And this is of the right type, integer. The squiggles have gone away. And now if I print the result, we should see the answer 101. 1 plus this implicit parameter 100. A couple of quick tips if you're using IntelliJ. First, if you open up the action menu and look for show implicit hints, or you do the sort of Kali Ma hand gesture that is required in order to activate it, it will actually show you what's being done, what the compiler is essentially writing for you at compile time. It's rewriting your program to just explicitly pass those values in. And you can always explicitly pass in implicit parameter lists. So I could have just said 100 like this. Let me remove implicit hints. Or I could have done 200, or I could have done default value. The Scala compiler essentially is rewriting our code to do this at compile time. But we don't have to do that explicitly, it's done implicitly, which can be confusing, especially for five-year-olds. Another tip would be to put your cursor on one of these methods that uses implicits, and then hit Command-Shift-P. This will show all of the implicit arguments and which ones were found, and it can jump you to the associated definitions, which could help if that implicit definition is, you know, off-screen or in some other file. Yay, it found it. So that's step one of implicit parameters. You have a parameter list that is marked as implicit, and then you have corresponding definitions that are also marked as implicit, and when you call a method not passing in an implicit parameter list, Scala will start searching high and low for these values of the corresponding type. Alas, there is one more step, because these don't always have to be just value definitions. These can also be defs, and this will work just the same. Let me show implicit hints. Yeah. It's able to find and call this def. But it gets one bit more complicated. These defs can also have their own implicit parameters. So here, I can have an implicit string, and the integer here could be the length of the string. Unfortunately, this is not able to work now because if you hit Command-Shift-P, IntelliJ will show you, well, it found this default value candidate, this method, but it could not find a string implicit for that one. So if we make a second implicit value, this time some string, hello, now everything compiles. And if we look at the implicit hint here, we could see that default value was called with string. And this recursion will just keep on going. So if this were an implicit definition with its own implicit arguments, that would keep working. If this had multiple implicit arguments, that's great. It would just keep finding and branching. As long as this created a DAG, which for five-year-olds would be a directed acyclic graph, all is well. And there are a couple of limitations. You cannot have ambiguous implicits, so I cannot have two values in the same scope at the same precedence of the same type of implicit. Now it just doesn't know which one to pick, and it's going to yell at us. So that's a problem. But that's really all there is to the basic mechanics of implicit parameters. And now on to implicit conversions. And there are actually two cases here as well where implicit conversions may fire. Let's look at them one at a time. The first is if you use some variable of type A in the place of type B. So let's say we have a case class name, which simply wraps a string. And then down here, let's have a name. But instead of passing in a name here, we'll just pass in a string. Now, usually this would be a compiler error, because a name is not a string, these are two different types. However, Scala is secretly looking for an implicit conversion behind the scenes, and if we define a method that goes from string to name and mark it as implicit, this will actually work. If I show implicit hints again, we'll see that it's calling this method. So this implicit conversion was fired because we used some type A in place of some type B, where it was expecting some type B, and thus Scala starts searching for an implicit function from type A to B. In this case, A was string and B was name. And if I remove this implicit keyword, it's sad. So the definition needs to be implicit and needs to be in scope. So that is the first case in which an implicit conversion will fire. The second case is a little more interesting. Let's have another string here, and let's call some method on it. Let's say announce. Now, as usual, this is going to be a compile error because string just does not have a method called announce on it. However, if we add a method announce to our name class, we'll see that the string to name conversion gets fired again. So this is the second case where an implicit conversion can get fired. If you have some type A and you call some method, which does not exist on type A, but there is another type B which does have that method, Scala will search for an implicit conversion from A to B and then call that conversion such that the method will exist. So that's really all there is to implicit conversions. And that's really all there is to implicits in general. But then there are also all of these crazy patterns built atop these mechanisms, such as type classes, extension methods, type level functions, and the so-called aux pattern. Lots of crazy things. But at their core, they're really just patterns built atop implicit parameters and implicit conversions.